All right, so good day everyone. I am Prasanth Bhuvaneswaran, a final year medical student from the National University of Malaysia. It's Tong Yung Xuan.
Good afternoon, I am Tong, also a final year medical student from UKM. We are currently in our emergency medicine posting and we are the forum moderators for today. Thank you for being here today with us for this webinar on the topic Clinical Toxinology, Is It Relevant to Medical Students?
Now, we would like to invite Associate Professor Ahmad Khaldun Ismail, the Program Advisor for today's forum, for his opening speech.
Okay, Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Very good afternoon to everyone. Thank you for attending this program. This is our first such a program for medical students for 2023. There will be three more programs after this. I hope those attending today will find it interesting to continue following the next programs until the end of the year. So this is actually a continuation of the effort that we did. We started in 2022, last year. We had three such of programs last year. And if you missed it, you can go back and watch them on YouTube. So we have the link for you later. Maybe the moderators can share the link in the chat box for our participants to go through the previous programs. So I would like to say thank you very much to our panelists, our esteemed panelists, Associate Professor, Professor Madia, Dr. Nariman from UNIMAS, Dr. Tri Maharani from Indonesia, and Dr. Nabil from Selayang Hospital. So they will be our panelists who will be our experts to response to any questions that you may have during the forum later. So without further ado, I would like to invite our moderators to start the ball rolling. All the best.
All right. Thank you so much, Prof, for the short and sweet opening speech. Next, I am honored to introduce our respected panelists for the forum today. We have a set of awesome panelists today, and I proudly present to you Dr. Tri Maharani. She is the leader of policy program in animal venomous and toxin plantation reduction in Ministry of Health in Republic of Indonesia. Dr. Tri has finished her undergrad studies in University of Brawijaya, and then she furthered her studies to become an emergency medicine specialist at Saiful Anwar General Hospital in Faculty of Medicine, University of Brawijaya, Indonesia. Her field of interest are in toxinology, especially in snake bites, plant and marine animal, followed by biomedicine, disaster, immunology, and cardiac emergency and bioterrorism toxin. Our next panelist would be Dr. Nabil Muhammad Al-Qudus. He is an emergency medicine physician and coordinator of pre-hospital care services unit from emergency and trauma department from Hospital Selayang. Dr. Nabil has completed his undergrad training in University of Putra Malaysia 2009, and subsequently he successfully completed his postgrad training in emergency medicine in 2021 at our very own University of Kebangsaan Malaysia. He is currently a member of Clinical Toxinology Special Interest Group SIG, and his focus of interest would be disaster medicine training, clinical toxinology, cardiac emergency and emergency critical care. Last but not least, we have Associate Professor Dr. Nariman Singh Mamin. So she is the Deputy Dean Undergrad Studies of Faculty of Medicine and Health Science from University of Malaysia Sarawak, UNIMAS. Prof. Nariman has completed her undergrad studies at Doe Medical College, Karachi, Pakistan. And she is currently a consultant emergency physician at Sarawak General Hospital and Sarawak Heart Center. Her focus of interest would be in simulation and training in medical education. We are very grateful and blessed to have all these amazing panelists today. Thank you, doctors. Thank you, Prof, for your time to be in our webinar today. Well, now, let's jump into a brief intro about what the topic that we are about to discuss today. Shall we, Tom?
Sure, let's go.
Okay. All right, Tong. Do you have any idea what the terms toxinology and clinical toxinology means?
I don't know if I got the correct understanding for it. Prasan, do you mind sharing more on it?
For sure. Toxinology simply means the scientific study of substances produced by living organisms, which are either delivered as venom or residing within tissues of animals, plants, mushrooms, and bacteria, which may subsequently harm the target organism. While clinical toxinology means encompasses a broad range of medical conditions resulting from envenomation by venomous terrestrial and marine organisms. And it can cause poisoning from ingestion of animal or plant toxin. Next, we shall know what are the differences between envenomation and poisoning. This is a common misconception on layman or public, and it is also common to mistake venom for poison or vice versa. So envenomation means the exposure to venom containing toxins resulting from bites or stings from venomous animals. While poisoning, it means the administration of poison containing natural toxins inside one body via swallowing, inhalation, or absorption through skin. We have a graphic to show you that could illustrate to us about the difference between the two commonly misinterpreted terms. Simply, venom is injected via stings and bites while poison is consumed. You are going to hear these terms a lot today, and I really hope it gives all the participants a clear understanding about what our discussion is going to be about today. So, Tong, what have you got to share to us today?
Okay, so prior to today's session, we have asked our friends who are currently doing their emergency posting two questions. The first one is, have you ever heard of clinical toxinology? And surprisingly, only 5.3% of them said yes. So I believe today's session will help the rest of our friends a lot. And the second question is, do you think it is relevant for medical undergraduates? And 86.8% of them said yes, and 13.2% of them said no.
Okay, that is about the students. What is your perception about this topic, Tom?
To be honest, I didn't know that there was a difference between toxinology and toxicology before this. I thought it's just the same or some typo. But I feel privileged to be able to participate this webinar as a moderator, because while I prepare for this webinar, I searched up and read more about toxinology, and to found that it is actually different. And I get to understand more about clinical toxinology and what kind of effect it's causing upon envenomation. And it's quite a very broad and big topic. And as I actually also prepared a case for discussion later, and I find it really interesting and very relevant to medical professionals about the progression of the patient's condition, and most importantly, how do we manage the patient. So next, in Malaysia, there are several organizations or groups that are working about clinical toxinology. First, we have Malaysian Society on Toxinology, MST, which is established in 1992. Next, we have Remote Envenomation Consultancy Services, RECS, which is established in 2010. And it is a risk management support system, which is developed to assist healthcare professionals at various levels for clinical management of envenomation or poisoning. Third, we have Clinical Toxinology Special Interest Group from College of Emergency Physicians. We also have the Malaysian Biodiversity Information System, and also National Poison Center, NPC, or Pusat Racun Negara, PRN. This is a page by the Malaysian Society on Toxinology, MST, and under the tab info and links, there are various guidelines and protocol on managing snake-related injuries. Whoever are interested, you can just Google up mstoxinology.blogspot.com and you will have your access to the page. Okay, so other than that, we also have this page, which is called the Venomous and Poisonous Animals Guide, the VAPA Guide. And you can select your animal of interest on the top there, the bar there, and you will get the management flowchart or a guideline to it. Okay, so Prasan, what is your opinion whether this topic is relevant for undergraduate curriculum? And if yes, how and when do you think it is the best timing to be taught or learned?
A good question, Tong. Honestly, if I were to answer before this, I would say I don't know, because there is very less exposure about this topic in the past 4 years of my medical school life. But after conducting a small research prior to this webinar, I would say I actually learned a lot. So now, I think it is very relevant to us, the future medical professionals who are going to be in the front line, receiving various kinds of patients, especially in emergency care settings. Or at least I think we should be equipped with the basic knowledge of identifying and managing patients with involving clinical toxinology, because they are mostly life-threatening, and most importantly, it's very common in Malaysia. And I feel this is the right time, as we are in emergency posting, speaking as an emergency posting student, or we can learn through family medicine, because it is involving in first-line management of patients where patients are presented acutely. So this is my point of view. Okay. Can we have one of the panelists maybe to share their opinions about this topic? Hello, doctor.
Yeah, hello. Thank you. Invite me to join in the meeting in the afternoon. In Indonesia, in the 3 p.m. now, yeah, 1 hour later from the Malaysia. Same, the in Indonesia, toxinology is a new era, for a new field of the medical student, and many medical students don't know about it and don't know important or not in my country. But you know, in Indonesia have many venomous animal, many cases of animal venomous or toxin plantation, and all cases is neglected. Many people dead about it, and many doctors don't know to helping many patients. I think medical students have good knowledge about the toxinology now. I remember if I'm a medical student 30 years ago, I think, no, don't know to the toxinology. If I'm finished to the my medical student and I am much working in mini hospital in Indonesia, or doctor, after to finish to medical student, I must go to 3 years to working in the mini hospital and remote area. And every day I have many cases about toxinology, and I don't know to helping them. I think it's the very important to medical student and very relevant to know this knowledge about the animal and plantation venomous and toxin, and first aid and to treatment these cases.
Okay, so from what Dr. Chimaharani said, can see that it's very common that these cases will happen all around there. And I believe that for us who are future doctors, when we graduate and work as housemen later, we will be posted to different areas, and including all the rural and remote areas, not all of us going to work in the city, right? So it's very important for us to be equipped with this kind of knowledge. Okay, so talking about this, I have a question for Dr. Nabil and Prof. Nariman. Was this clinical toxinology topic was taught during your undergraduate's time?
Okay, assalamualaikum and a very good afternoon. Thank you so much to the medical students, to Prof. Khaldun, my panelists as well, for having me in this webinar. So actually, during my undergraduate years in Malaysia, I think we have never been there is not much exposure, or I would say zero exposure, towards clinical toxinology. I was taught in our local university for undergraduate. So in terms of exposure towards clinical toxinology at that time, it was not there wasn't any exposure, lah, I would say. And looking back now, I would really say that probably clinical toxinology, looking into venoms and also poisons, would have been very much helped expose me or give the basic understanding of clinical toxinology, which can be will be very useful, especially when we are in when we are going to the most challenging part of our career, the housemanship period, yeah, the internship period. So it is very important we get all the knowledge that we are need to equip ourselves when we are in this challenging situation. Because you know, when you are in internship, you have a lot of practical things that you must do, a lot of ward work and all that. So you might not have enough time to actually equip yourself with certain knowledge. So that all the knowledge, even the minute knowledge that you have during your medical student time, will actually help you during your housemanship. So this is one of the main reasons why I believe, I advocate for clinical toxinology to be a part of the curricula in medical students.
Prof. Nariman, you have anything to add on?
Regarding what you said, the question whether I learned this during my medical school, I would say yes, because I studied in Karachi, Pakistan, and a lot of venom over there. So usually it's integrated in pharmacology. We have a different pharmacology. This is more to Commonwealth University. So in year three, we have pharmacology the whole year, about 6 months. Actually, the pharmacology is 1 year, year three. So it's quite broad pharmacology, and we cover a bit in about venom, but it's not in detail like now. That's all. What you said, if you ask me whether it is important, yes, it's quite important to know. Now I'm posted in Sarawak, and Sarawak we have many cases, venomous cases like a sting bite and snake bites or stings and all, which we usually receive in emergency department. So you at least you need to have some exposure in during medical school. Maybe you cannot remember, you will not remember the name of the drugs and what's the doses, but at least you're exposed to the knowledge. Okay. Can I answer whether this is what the best time for you all to learn? Because I'm a deputy dean of undergraduate in UNIMAS, so, and I'm teaching also emergency medicine, and I put it in year five. I don't know in KM which year we are running emergency medicine. Which year? Is it year four or year five?
Yes, prof. We are currently year five, and we are doing our practical, yes, in year five.
So same as well in UNIMAS, we have the emergency medicine. It's in the 3 weeks in year five. So we cover a bit about toxicology, but not toxicology, but the most important, we have also our elective university, which we covered basic first aid. And in basic first aid, we cover all this, mostly we cover all the toxicology or toxicology. Okay. So a bit we cover, it's not in detail. I think it's not detail like Prof. Khaldun doing with you all. It's just like touch here and bit about one lecture, about 2 hours lecture and a practical. Family medicine posting is in year four. Usually we don't cover this topic in family medicine, but my suggestion was to integrate some of the information in internal medicine about the treatment and management of patient, because this is continuation of care from emergency to medical department. So they agreed, maybe we integrate one topic or two topics, how to take care of the patient from emergency department to the ward, internal medicine. Okay, this is my opinion.
Hey, Prasad, is that okay? So I think
yeah, sure,
it's a very, very interesting insight that we get from our experts today. But I think as Dr. Nabil was saying, even though you have the knowledge or you can't remember the knowledge, but at least I hope by the end of the day, as a student, the take home is you know who to call for help. I think as we know, we can't remember everything. We can become expert after this just 1 hour session, but at least at the end of the day, we know who to call if we have a patient with, for example, snake bite, right? Coming to emergency department, we are an intern. We have never seen a snake bite before, even during our medical school. So who to call? Who do we consult? So I think that's the main thing that we try to put forward here. And I think Tong was saying just now, there are a few website or application or information. And this source of information is important as well, because we cannot just select anything on the internet for our reference, because as you know, we are unique in terms of species in Malaysia, species in America is different from us, species in Australia is different from us. So we have different signs and symptoms of envenoming for our country. So for example, Dr. Nariman said in Pakistan, right? She studied there, and they have different snake species, different to Malaysia. So their antivenom is also different from Malaysia. So it's like you can't make a kind of a standard, program to teach for this area from anywhere in the world. So you have to be tailor-made to the country that you are in. So they said, for example, I graduated from Ireland. And Ireland doesn't have any snakes at all. So we never see a snake at all during my school years. Okay. So in that stand, yes, we do not need to do study about snake bite in Ireland. But when I came back to Malaysia as a junior doctor at that time, I find that I have zero knowledge about snake bite. So that kind of sets me into this journey to learn more, like what Tong and Prasant were saying. They didn't know anything until comes to a time when they were given a task, an assignment to look for it. So they find that, oh, it's a whole new world out there, right, on toxinology. So this is what we want to look for. Maybe Dr. Nabil want to share a bit about his experience as well when, as a junior doctor compared to when he comes as a master student?
Yes. I think my experience will be similar to yours, Prof. Khaldun. I think even though you were coming back from overseas, even though I was, graduated locally, however, the amount of exposure on toxinology, specifically in terms of venoms or poison, were minimal in the undergraduate years. I think like Prof. Shariman has put it, we only learn the general basics in terms of pharmacology in preclinical years. When we go to our clinical years, in terms of fourth and fifth year, I had the pleasure of being in HKL, trained in HKL, and also in Hospital Serdang at the time. So during that time, our main exposure was regarding the general common medical disorders or surgical disorders, surgical diseases. We had zero knowledge. Very, 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 probably less than 2-3% of knowledge regarding anything on poisoning or toxinology, to be specific. Even when I graduated and was a house officer, and also a junior medical officer, the exposure to clinical toxinology wasn't much. You had to do your own reading. And I remember at that time, Google wasn't around yet as much as we around. In the years of 2009 and 2010, internet in Malaysia, was not vast. You don't get any of smartphone all internet exposure. So you get minimal amounts of exposures, information on your internet, in your phone. So you still need to go through books. We were using Sarawak Handbook. That was the guide for house officers. But however, you do must understand that books outdate. So the information in books become outdated with more knowledge that we conjure up. So we the knowledge is very important. So my knowledge on toxinology only came about mainly during my later years in as a medical officer, and going into master's in UKM and finally meeting Prof. Calden, then the exposure came along more, you know. So yes, it's all about exposure actually. So once you have the exposure, especially in a very young part of your medical student life or the medical profession, then that knowledge will keep you going. So even though you don't have too much, you don't remember the dosage, you don't remember the species, you don't remember what exactly the mechanism, but you will still remember somehow, you still retain your information, and you know, like Prof. Calden said, who to call. That's the most important thing that I would like to say.
I think in UKM at one time, they were studying about snakes in by parasitology. In during parasitology class in, I think, undergraduate preclinical year, but that has been discontinued when emergency medicine started, because we invite a clinical student to come to our during clinical year in emergency medicine posting, so parasitology stopped teaching about snakes. So yeah, so because in a snake is not a parasite, so why is it put under their responsibility to teach about snakes? So yeah, so that's the funny story in the past lah. So this time I think we hope that we can improve on the teaching of this subject. So it's very big, right? It's not just snake bites. The toxinology is involving all kinds of venoms and toxins.
All right. So thank you so much, doctors and prof, because it really inspires me to learn more about clinical toxinology. I mean, it's really fun to know your undergrad experience and what you think about this. Okay, for all of your information, we, me and Tong, have prepared two cases to be discussed today from both me and Tong. So Tong will start with her case first.
Okay, so the first case is about a 13-year-old Chinese boy who had an alert snake bite. So my patient was on, this happened on 7th of August 2022, and my patient was on the way back from throwing rubbish outside his house, and near a bushes area, he suddenly felt a bite over the left lower limb, and he saw a black snake. After one bite, the snake slipped off away. And he shouted pain at the bite site immediately with a pain score of 5 out of 10. So he went home, his caretaker expressed the blood from the wound and applied some traditional Chinese medicated oil over the wound. And closed tourniquet was done over the left lower limb proximal to the bite site. Subsequently, he also developed bruising over the bite site. He presented at the emergency department 15 minutes post-incident with increase in intensity of pain, and now the pain score is 7 out of 10. And there's also localized swelling noted. Otherwise, there was no shortness of breath, no chest pain, no vomiting, no loss of consciousness, and no tosis. So upon arrival, he is hypertensive with blood pressure at 146/89, tachycardic with the heart rate at 101 beats per minute, respiratory rate 22 breaths per minute. The oxygen saturation is 98% under room air and not febrile with full GCS. The cardiovascular, respiratory, and abdomen was all normal. So on inspection of the left lower limb, at the medial aspect of the distal shin, we can see that there is a bite mark with surrounding swollen and erythematous, which is shown at the white arrow there. And there is also dermonecrosis with blackish discoloration measuring 2x2 cm, which is tender on palpation. Otherwise, the posterior tibial artery and the dorsalis pedis artery is palpable, and the left lower limb neurological examination was also normal. He was started on IV fentanyl 50 mic and IV morphine 2 milligram, anti-tetanus toxin, Nexium, and also Maxolon. So after 7 hours, his pain score improved from 7 out of 10 to 3 to 4 out of 10. So at 7:30 a.m., he developed generalized body weakness and with bilateral ptosis. On examination, he was alert but noted to be lethargic. He is still hypertensive at 148/85, tachycardic at 109 beats per minute, and tachypneic ranging from 26 to 30 breath per minute. Despite that, his oxygen saturation was 100% under room air. The swelling is increasing distally, and there is mild increase over the proximal area. The necrotic zone remained the same. So Rex was consulted regarding the case, and the patient was up triaged to the resuscitation zone for antivenom. At 8:27, he was started on IV Najakautia antivenom, 10 vials in 500 ml of normal saline over 1 hour. And there was no anaphylactic reaction and side effects towards the antivenom. Upon completion of the antivenom, the pain score reduced to 2 out of 10. And the patient was admitted to high dependency ward and medical ward for further care. And here's a picture showing the topsis. The one above is before patient had the antivenom, and the one below showing the topsis has resolved upon completion of the antivenom. So on day two of admission, he was well, but there's still pain over the right side with pain score 2 to 3 out of 10. However, he was febrile at 38.5 degrees Celsius. The swelling over the right side on the left lower limb now is measuring 4 times 4 centimeters with necrotic area with tenderness up until below knee level. And it is erythematous and warm to touch. The left lower limb pulses were still good and palpable. So he was given the impression of left lower limb cellulitis secondary to alleged snake bite, and he was started on IV unicin and paracetamol for analgesia, and on fluid normal saline 3 pints per day. So on day 3, patient was well and no longer febrile with a pain score of 1 to 2 out of 10. He was reviewed by the orthopedics team in view of having swelling and necrotic area over the bite site. And he was diagnosed with dermonecrosis of posterior aspect of distal left leg with myositis. He was managed with daily dressing and to continue on unicin and analgesia. He was uneventful on day 4 and day 5 of admission. So throughout the 5 days of admission, his vital signs remained stable. His pain score improved over time despite having the swelling and the bone necrosis over the bite site. And he does not develop any complications such as compartment syndrome or any severe anaphylactic reaction. Upon discharge on day 5, there was no pus or crepitus, just the necrotic patch with the surrounding wound with erythema. So his condition was constantly updated to Rex and also the orthopedics team throughout his admission. And he was discharged with antibiotic unicin for daily dressing at clinic primer, and to review him under orthopedics clinic in 1 week time. So here shows the progression of the wound throughout the 5 days of stay. We can see that there was increase in erythematous and swelling zone around the bite site with a formation of, we can see the blisters and also the necrotic zone. So this is a very interesting case, and this is my first exposure to a snake bite case. And now I would like to invite our panelists to give their comments or opinion on the case. Dr. Nabe, would you like to go first?
All right. Thank you, Tong. Okay. For me, I would say my first thoughts when you discuss this case would be a pediatric. I mean, it's 13, but in most countries, we still consider that as a pediatric age group. Young with coming in with a probably an accidental bite over the lower limbs. Yeah? So it's happened in a urban setting, isn't it? Yeah. So, and then when he came in, I mean, one of the things that I noticed, I mean, it's common, I think, not only in Malaysia, but many countries, is the inappropriate usage of first aid It's most likely due to our community's awareness regarding appropriate health-seeking behavior. So this is one of the things that I would like to first highlight, lah, because one thing is the community has to be empowered first. So if the community is well aware of the proper health-seeking behavior and the proper first aid treatments that they're supposed to administer, then we can prevent complications or adverse events as a result of worsening the area. Because of course, in this case, we cannot comment much on whether it was worsened or not by the initial first aid that was inappropriately given. But however, it demonstrates that our community still and many other communities still holds on to quite a number of traditional beliefs. So this is something that is difficult to change, of course, but we hope with proper education regarding proper health seeking behavior, which, and also proper health first aid training of the community, we can improve that. So that is regarding the first aid. But however, it was surprising that when the pain, I think the, one of the most important symptom or triggering factor for any patient would be pain. So when they try something, they try a remedy, and that remedy is not really working. The only thing that will prompt them to come to the hospital is pain, because pain is something that none of us can really withstand, especially when the pain score goes up to 10, you know. So anything else, swelling, blister, they'll say, it's okay, give it time, give it time. But when pain, it's the number one symptom that will always prompt someone to seek medical attention. And it was apparent in this case also, pain score was 7. He came to the emergency department, and it was quite fast that he came to the emergency department. So we noticed that there was some elevation in his vital signs, not something significant. It's just mainly pain score. So that was significant. One of the symptoms, signs that was obvious was the dermonecrosis. So this dermonecrosis, which is basically a local envenomation sign, is we can almost instantaneously, we can actually know that this is from a particular species in Malaysia. And this species is from the cobra, ataupun we call it a Najah species. Whether it's Najah Kautia or Najah Sumatrana, we cannot ascertain that. But what we can ascertain, it's from a Najah species, which is a cobra, and most definitely it is a elapid. So definitely, so this will straight away give you the idea that what we are looking at is most likely a local envenomation plus some amount of, if there is systemic involvement, it's going to be neurological, because it's going to be a neurotoxin. So that is why knowledge is important, because if this is the first time you are looking at this case, then you might just think it as, oh, there is local envenomation. And then you might see some bruising. And then first thing, you would probably straight away think, hey, could it be hematotoxic? You know? So a lot of first timers, even I, probably if you asked me 10 years ago, I would have said, this is some bruising there. Could it be hematotoxic viper or something, you know? So that is one of the things that I like to highlight, that knowledge regarding snake bites or in general any animal bites is very important. So subsequently, of course, the patient developed systemic symptoms and the appropriate antivenom was given. Appropriate follow-ups was done, and the patient was actually discharged well. So, all in all, it's a good case to review, and quite a number of good take home messages, especially regarding the diagnosis from the various departments. You see, I see a lot of diagnoses that varies from the emergency, but this diagnosis that was taken from the medical team, isn't it? One from medical team, one from the orthopedic team. So you can see if the patient remained the emergency department, you probably get another diagnosis. atau impression, you see. So this tells you that even among specialty, the lack of insight regarding clinical toxinology. Yeah.
Thank
actually,
you, Doctor.
Well done. They consult reps faster. So as you said, we need to call for help. This is rule number one in emergency, right? If you don't know, you need to activate the team and call for help as soon as possible. And whether it's medical or pediatric, pediatrician to come in and involve in the management is okay. I think it's true, right, Dr. Khaldun? Either PEDS or medical, either one, they can treat the patient. And as mentioned by Dr. Nabil, pain relief is number one. So what brought the patient there, it was a pain, but we found a lot of complication. So I think this is multidisciplinary approach, which is quite good in this patient. And by that, the patient survived and discharged, though after a week. So, okay.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Nabi and Prof. Nariman.
About this case, because Indonesia also have a lot of cobra, they're probably slightly different species to ours, but they are still cobras.
Yeah, doctor. Okay, thank you. Same the comment of Dr. Khaldun. Indonesia have many cases about cobra, yeah, doc. If Dr. Khaldun come to Indonesia, I'm consult to Dr. Khaldun many cases about cobra, but the different species in Java, Bali, and West Nusa Tenggara, Indonesia have Najas putatik cobra Jawa, and the Sumatra, Borneo, and a little island in Sulawesi, Indonesia have Najas sumatrana. But the case of the cobra, every day I have. Now I am hearing your comment and your discussion. I have two cases in my phone and not far from my living in Jakarta. Near my living in Bekasi and Tangerang, many cases about Naja sputatik, because I think in Indonesia, Naja sputatik is very adaptive snake. Yeah, it's true, yeah, Dr. Khaldun, yeah. The snake very adaptation. And Indonesia have many cases, not only in the forest, not only in the agriculture, but in the hospital. I have the big hospital, the cobra, 35 cobra in the one of the part of this hospital. And the hotel also, and the many home, house, or the many area in Java, many cases of the cobra. And I think the two problem in Indonesia, one about the first aid. You know, in Indonesia, many people and many brain, many idea about the first aid. The traditional healer about the first aid cobra make many cases not okay to the helping in the medical. I'm very happy about in 2012, Dr. Khaldun invite me go to the Kuala Lumpur and studying toxin. Yeah, and I'm back to give information to many friends and many doctors in Indonesia. Cobra in Indonesia is the difficult cases, and Indonesia have the second problem about antivenom. You know, antivenom of Najas putatik, special from my country also, the production, the biopharma production with the BioSafe, biopharma serum antivenom, and include three species, Najas putatik, Calus elasmorhodostroma, and Bungarus fasciatus. And many cases, because the production not enough to all Indonesia, every year Indonesia have 135,000 cases. I think now it's very increased, but the production of antivenom only 40 1,000. I think not enough to handle all cases in Indonesia. And many cases, cobra or elapid, I think, Bungarus candidus, that about not enough this antivenom. And yeah, traditional healer. I think late to come to the hospital to the have medication and the good drug, antivenom from the medical. I hope, because now Indonesia have the program and Ministry of Health, the last year, this program, the building, and now we have the slogan of zero mortality about the snake bite. I hope the next year, the year 2023, many cases about cobra, not death, not morbidity also, and not disability also.
Yeah, maybe a comment from Dr. Nabil, because Dr. Nabil's thesis is on Nanja species. So maybe about, yeah. So we are about to publish or send for publication manuscript, hopefully. So maybe Dr. Nabil can give a little bit of information about the antivenom or species of species now also involving Sarawak, is it?
Okay. So in terms of, I think there's a few things I don't want, maybe once our publication comes out, they can have a more in-depth review, but just a sneak peek, Prof. So in terms of Naja species, I think we have two species in Malaysia. One is Naja sumatrana and Naja kautia. So Naja sumatrana is widely distributed. I mean, it actually is distributed the whole of East Malaysia. It is well known to be in the Monyo and also throughout Malaysia in the peninsula. But we have not recently in the last few years, in the past 5 years, noticed more cases of Naja kautia from Thailand, from the distance of Thailand, borders of Thailand, and also the northern regions of Malaysia, coming towards the southern parts of Malaysia. And we are also seeing a couple of cases also in Borneo states. So those are the geographical differences in terms of the two species. We also noticed that Naja kautia, surprisingly, actually found to be actually more neurotoxic compared to Naja sumatrana. But of course, these can be actually verified more because there's a lot of studies regarding venomics, the toxins itself, the phospholipids and all that from the various species. And we've also come to know that species from different geographical places also contain different amounts of toxin composition. The amount of neurotoxins and also the amount of the local cytotoxic content. So probably Naja kautia from Thailand is different in terms of venom composition compared to Naja kautia of Malaysia, compared to probably Naja of Indonesia. So that is something that we have to note, and also it will actually help in decision making in terms of management as well. Because when it comes to what you call management, we need to know and we need to have the once, especially when we can identify the snake, because with the help of Rex, of course, because if you don't have knowledge, then it's going to be difficult. So early consultation with Rex will help you in terms of identification of the species. And if once, especially if you have the dead species, you know, if sometimes you can catch the species, not re-catch, I mean, the local authorities might have got a caught of the captured snake, or the snake has been killed. So they bring the dead species and for identification. So we can actually identify and we can know that, okay, if this is a Naja kautia, we want to be a bit more cautious because the likelihood of them developing neurotoxicity will be high. So then when you are the treating doctor, you'll be more meaning you will be more careful, or you will be more monitoring them more closely. Not to say that you don't. So probably if you want to go more closely during the early periods, no? And that's why we also educate regarding rate of proximal progression and pain score and things like that. Yep, that's a bit about our Naja species, Prof.
Thank you. I would like to welcome Dr. Zainal, our REX chairperson, to this webinar. So Dr. Zainal, he's the eminent consultant for REX, actually. So thank you, Dr. Zainal. So shall we move? Do we have any questions to put forward?
Yes, Prof. We have a question from one of the participants. Okay, so the participant would like to ask about any snake bit in disaster area, example like flood, earthquake, volcano, that could be a delay for referral to hospital. So are there any SOPs or first aid for volunteers? So can you have any of the panelists to answer this question?
Maybe Dr. Maha, disaster and snake bite.
Yeah,
can share our experience.
Yes, and 2019, yeah, Dr. Khaldun, remember, yeah, tsunami in Banten. The group of the music in Indonesia, the famous group 17 Dead. And after the disaster at 23 December, I think, 24, I go to the Banten with the corona. Dr. Khaldun know the Dr. Corona, yeah, the expert disaster in Indonesia, yeah, and this team. And
yeah, nothing to do with coronavirus, his name is Corona.
Yeah, not coronavirus, but name of the expert emergency disaster in Indonesia named Dr. Corona. And we go to the Banten. And the 4 days, many cases about Calosilas marodostoma, Doc. And I remember I call Dr. Khaldun to discussion, Doc, because the after disaster, after tsunami, and after the flood, because tsunami continued with disaster flood in this Banten and the area from Lebak and this, I think, Tanjung Lesung. Four days, I have 16 cases about Calosilas marodostoma, only 4 days. Because the many snake, Calosilas snake, I think Dr. Khaldun gave the comment, yeah, Doc, yeah, about this, why the Calosilas many cases in this after tsunami. I look the all cases about the people go back to the area and, yeah, you know, the many building damage. And the people back to menyelamatkan hartanya yang tertinggal. And not to give this material from this home of house, but give the beaten of the Calosilas marodostoma. And I give advice to many people in this shelter about not go to the tsunami area if not the PPA, because if not the boat, not to give the glove, I think very, very dangerous to go to the area of the disaster. And this last year, the Semeru volcano, I have the unique also the experience about snake. I think now my friend, Mas Fatoni from the University of Brawijaya, the PhD of the nursing, yeah, join also in this meeting. I go to the Semeru and I look many cases about Trimeresurus. I think I'm report to Dr. Carl also, many Trimeresurus after the volcano from the mountains, the volcano mountains in the East Java.
I think our first one was a long time ago with the Green Pit Viper in
yes. Yeah. And Bondowoso.
Bondowoso. That was before the volcano erupt.
Yeah.
Suddenly there was a very high number of cases of people got bitten by Green Pit Viper just before the volcano eruption. So it appears that the animal can sense the maybe disruption in the earth, and they try to run away from the mountain and come down.
Just before the
volcano erupt, and a lot of people got bitten during that time.
Yeah, I think it's a good good comment from Prof. Mm-hmm. Because I know before many cases, and you remember the Agung Mountains in Bali,
yes.
2017, same also. Before the volcano, many cases of the Green Pit Viper, but Trimeresurus insularis in Bali, I think.
Yeah, maybe Dr. Zainal can comment about how flooding, maybe at the moment, Pahang is also at risk of flooding and also snake bite in Malaysia. Is there any relationship? There appears to be a relationship between natural disaster and the risk of snake bite and venomation. So we always take precaution about this, Dr. Maha said, you need to wear protective equipment and protective gear before you go and do the, what you call, gotong royong to clean up the places. So, so that is always a standard procedure for, safety guideline on how to approach a disaster area. Okay, so maybe Dr. Zainal, are you ready? Can comment a bit about flooding and snake bite. Is there any relationship in Pahang or Kelantan or Terengganu?
Thank you very much. Can you hear me?
Okay. Yes.
Okay. I don't think it's so much different. There are a few cases of snake bites that had been attended during this flooding season. But it is not so much a significant increase in numbers, but I think the incidences are quite if a bit increased, but it is not really directly related to the flood season. I think for the flood season in Malaysia for this probably. At the end of 2022, the duration of flood is not so so long, but probably done within a 2 weeks duration. But we don't for me I don't see any significant increase in numbers that related to snake bite with the flood area. Probably because of most of the time patient is back to goes to the flood relieving relief centers, and even in they also go back to their home, and then it is not I'm not sure, but I think there's not really related to any flood area. In my what I observed here, even the previous flood season also, it is not really significant increase or related to flood itself. Okay, thank you.
All right. So maybe you have any other questions or case to share, Tom?
Yes, we actually have a question in the chat box, but we'll keep this question for our forum Q&A session later because we still have a second case by Prasan.
Okay, so the second case for today is about a centipede bite. Maybe it's not as complicated as Tong's case just now. But actually, I was quite surprised that centipedes can be dangerous also after finding about this case. So This date of incident was in 3 November 2022. So the patient had a right around 12 a.m. It occurred when the patient was sleeping and was woken up by a sudden sharp sting at the medial aspect of right forearm. And she noted a bite or sting mark and oozing blood on the medial right forearm. And when she woke up from the bed, she found a 10 cm long red centipede, but unable to catch it. But they were able to take the picture of the centipede. Maybe I'll show the picture on next slide. So at the moment, the pain score was 6 over 10. Otherwise, he has no nausea, vomiting, loss of consciousness, dyspnea, chest pain, or palpitation. And upon arrival at ED, the patient was alert, oriented to time, place, and person. All her vital signs and GCS were normal, except for her heart rate. She was tachycardic. Otherwise, systemic review did not reveal any abnormalities. So at that moment in ED, the patient was given antitetanus. Spleen and immobilization were applied to her right arm. IV tramadol was given too. So as you can see, this is the picture of the centipede. It was 10 cm long. So the diagnosis given at the moment during her arrival in ED was centipede bite over the right medial aspect of right forearm with local inflammation. I think we can appreciate the bruises over the medial aspect of right forearm over there. So the plan was to give pain control, continue immobilization, and discharge if the pain was controlled. And then after 6 hours, the patient was reassessed on the same day. And after 6 hours, the patient was well with the pain score of 1 over 10. She was not febrile, no allergy, and the right forearm did not have any worsening or worsening bruises or hematoma. And her heart rate was also normal after that, at 78 beats per minute, and her other vitals were also normal. And at the time, the patient was allowed to be discharged with cloxacillin, paracetamol, and also diclofenac.
Okay, in Sarawak, usually we have many cases, such cases, centipede bite, and the way they come to us, they're really in severe pain and they're really scared actually whether they're going to die from that centipede bite, right? Whether they can, whether they need antivenom. So one of the patients, I remember, insisted to give they asked us to give them her antivenom that time. They said, don't cool down, relax, we're going to give you painkiller. And she was like, after 6 hours, she was okay. She asked us to discharge her as soon as possible to go back, okay? Because, so as mentioned by first case also, the reason why they come in is the pain. It's really painful. All right. So relieve the pain and we can settle other things. Okay. So itu sajalah from my side. Tapi many, it's very common case even in Sarawak.
Okay. I think it's not just centipede. You have a spider bite.
A spider, yeah.
You have scorpion bite, a scorpion sting as well in Sarawak.
Yeah.
So treatment macam mana? What do you think? The treatment? Any comment? Is it sufficient? Is there any sign of infection?
No, Prof.
No, right? So probably Cloxa is main. What do you think, Zena? Do you think centipede need prophylaxis? This is prophylaxis, I assume.
Yeah,
it is for this patient and even the other patient also, we don't. No need for us to start antibiotics at that moment, at that time.
What is the patient pain score? Now it's 1.1 over 10.
Yes. Upon discharge, the pain score was 1 over 10, but was still given paracetamol and diclofenac.
Why not choose one?
So true.
So if you were to choose one, which one would you like to give?
Paracetamol, maybe, Prof.
Yeah, I think so too.
Yeah.
Okay.
Prof, I have a question personally. So let's say if we got the centipede bite at home, but the pain was tolerable, is there a need for us to approach to any medical care or help?
Maybe Dr. Zainal or Dr. Nabil can answer.
I guess with centipedes bites, correct me if I'm wrong, I mean, the worry is if there is any reaction to it, whether it's a systemic or local. So they could get something like more of a anaphylactic-like kind of reaction. So if there is symptoms like that, they can probably come to the first aid room, or they can get it from the local GP also. They not necessarily need to flood the emergency care center for every single animal or insect bite, you see, because emergencies should stick to emergency. So if pain is tolerable, there's only local reactions, I would say they could actually treat it at home with if they have home medications, or if they have paracetamol, they don't necessarily need to see this. And or they can go to the local GP, yeah, or the clinic kesehatan as well. There's always room for the family medicine specialist also to review. So they are also involved in the first line treatment. So except if there is a full-blown anaphylaxis reaction, things like that, then you probably want to escalate it to the emergency room. Otherwise, you don't necessarily need to go to the emergency department. Yeah. Probably Dr. Zainal now add on, gets to.
I had been bit stung by centipede when I was in childhood. But you know, even though it was painful, we just stayed at home. Okay, so it depends. The risk of in centipede bite, most of the time is patient come mainly because of pain. If tolerable, then probably the self medication at home with analgesia appropriately. But another thing is if it is any risk for some of the arthropod bites, whether it is at high risk of the tetanus or not. If the ATT is required, then probably patients still required to come to hospital or to the nearest healthcare facility to get that. But if the risk is low, probably you just can stay at home and then look at the whether most of the time in centipede bite the wound will most of the time it is just stays there, and by within 6 hours probably the pain is reduced and the swelling is not increasing. I think it still can stay at home, but the best is if you are not so confident, and then probably to seek medical help at the nearest medical facility is better. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Zainal and Dr. Nabil. So we have a question in the chat box there, which is from our participant Muriel. So he asked about, does the application of tourniquet may slow down the envenomation? Can I maybe Dr. Nariman, can you help to answer this question?
Okay. We have a lot of cases because Sarawak is quite big. So when the patient comes to us after snake bite, the always I see a tourniquet is there. Okay. So what we do usually, we don't remove the tourniquet. We stabilize the patient, put the IV line, and slowly we remove and see how is it. The question whether the tourniquet can slow down, from the AHA, American Heart Association, they said, please don't put the tourniquet, okay? Just immobilize the wound. Compress, bandage, immobilize, and send to hospital as soon as possible. Many times already we give the advice during our first aid classes or training to the public that please don't put too much tourniquet too much pressure, so you will lose the limb. Sometimes there's nothing there. It's just the tourniquet will kill the limb instead of the venom, right? But still, I can see that whatever going to say, they still the belief is there. The tourniquet is slowing down the spread of the venom. Okay. So for me, I would say no need to put the tourniquet. Just compress, bandage, immobilize, bring back to hospital as soon as possible. But I don't know whether Nabil or Dr. Zainal got different opinion regarding this. Okay.
Maybe can you have Dr. Tri to comment about this application of tourniquet? Yeah,
thank you. In Indonesia, tourniquet is very famous. All patients come to hospital with tourniquet.
And yes, same like Sarawak, I think.
Yeah, same problem. Same.
Yeah.
And 2 months ago, I go to Badui. You know, Badui is the little of community, the remote community. And I must to helping one patient about the colostomy bite. I'm very surprised because the patient, 30 years, very young woman, 30 years, I think, yeah, with the tourniquet. And you know, the tourniquet is 2 weeks, 14 days with the necrosis. And I'm very sad because this young lady must to loss of the part of the leg. Yeah, because this cases, I have a program, the zero mortality and zero disability also, and give the education about the good first aid, immobilize, and the pressure bandage immobilize, and go to the mini hospital or hospital. I hope the next here and next month, I think, yeah, community, the remote community in Badui have the education about the first aid is good, not tourniquet with the a long time, because many people have disability about the wrong first aid. Yeah.
Dr. Maha, I have a question. So other than having the tourniquet, is there any other type of improper first aid methods that is widely used by the community, but they shouldn't do that?
Yeah. I think the first aid is very important to Indonesia, because I think prevention very cheaper about the curative. You know, it's curative need the antivenom, and antivenom expensive in Indonesia. Yeah? But the first aid is the important education, important knowledge to medical student. And I think in all medical student must know this first aid about the snake, the immobilize and pressure bandit. And I think pet immobilize with pressure bandit, because in Indonesia have the one species, Daboya simanensis, and East Nusa Tenggara. And you know, in the guideline WHO 2016, the first aid with the part pressure bandit and immobilization. I think all medical students must know and must understand to helping many people with the snake bite in this area and his this hospital or the mini hospital.
Thank you, Dr. Maha. So for your information, we actually compiled some questions from our emergency department students that they would like to know from the panelists. Okay, so the first one is if there are still many unidentified species of snakes and spiders out there, so how do we generally treat the patient if we don't know the species and what kind of antivenom that we should give? Maybe Dr. Narima, would you like to answer to this?
Usually we have to look at the patient's symptom, what's the treat symptomatically, but also at the same time, we try our best, what's the sign and symptom they give that time, okay? So we need to monitor the patient. We cannot say that, oh, this is dry bite, we just discharge the patient. We need to observe them and see whether what type of symptom or sign to help us in treating the patient, okay? So most of the time like that we do, okay? We need to observe and monitor the patient. Also, we need to use a few investigations to help us in the diagnosis, okay? If like identified snake, we need to observe and see.
Okay, thank you, Prof. So another interesting question from one of our students is, will the body produce certain antibody after the first exposure to venom? And what will happen during the subsequent exposure to the same venom or poison? Maybe we can have Dr. Nabil to answer this question.
Okay, so from the, I guess, our reaction towards anti-venom, because anti-venom is not produced by our bodies, you know, so it is something that is foreign, so it's outside the body. So the reaction towards any anti-venom is, I mean, there is belief that there is some belief from especially snake charmers, you know, that they believe that injecting small amounts of the venom in the long term actually helps them to develop antibodies in their bloodstream. So those are one of the things that people believe. But scientifically, I think there is no obvious evidence to say that you actually will actually, with the amount of you getting and venomation from a specific species, you were envenomated for the second time or third time, your reaction would be less or milder compared to the primary time, the first time you get envenomated from that species or that specific insect or animal. Yeah, so that would be my, maybe the other panelists would like to add on.
Our body, our normal body reaction towards any foreign body, especially proteins, definitely we will produce antibodies, and that's how antivenom is produced. It inject the venom to the host, and then the host produce the antibodies, and they get the antibodies to use as the antivenom. So the same as us, yes, we do have produce antibody towards that venoms or even the antivenom itself. And then if been asked whether is there any effects of the second envenoming towards if the patient has antibodies. The risk is yes. Yes, there's still a risk. Either it become more hypersensitive or it goes to the act on the venom to neutralize. That's a theoretical ideas. But if I'm not mistaken, there are a few reported or what. Those one or two person, they tried to immunize them with the multiple time of given the venoms to their body, but actually they don't develop the immunity towards the venoms afterwards. I'm not sure what are the probably because they don't produce this very specific, or I'm not sure why, but it is so far we don't I cannot hear I don't know any of the evidence to say that human become immune toward the certain venoms if they've been envenomed a few times. So to say that, is there any reaction? Still potential. But another one, we also have experience of one of the vet. They are handling snakes, but he was not probably been bitten before. But then afterwards, there was once when he was bitten by snakes, I think a viper. But then he develops allergic reaction. So to say that, is there any reaction, hypersensitivity towards the second exposure to the venoms? I think it is there. But to say that, would a person become immune toward the venoms if they have been exposed to multiple times of envenoming? We don't have any good evidence to say that. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Zainal and Dr. Nabil. So our next question is, in Malaysia, what is the fastest venom or poison that can kill a person? And what can be done for the first person who encounter the problem? Dr. Nabil, would you like to answer this?
So, I mean, if you are bitten by a venomous snake species, is it? That was the question. I mean, if you are bitten and you know it is, because sometimes identification is hard, especially if you are in the wild, you see. I mean, mostly what we get is occupational related ataupun tourists, whether it's local or foreign tourists on going outside in the outdoors. So if you are bitten, the first would be, of course, first aid, because nobody prepares on trips and brings anti-venom with them. Yeah? Except you are going on special trips and you have conditions or this one, even then it's very difficult to bring in anti-venoms. You need to have regulations and all that. So I would say if you are bitten by a venomous animal, then the first aid would be to ask the patient to remain calm. It's going to be very difficult, but reassure the patient, ask the patient to remain calm. That is the most beneficial thing that you can do as a first aider. And then, of course, to immobilize the affected limb and finding the nearest healthcare facility. Okay, so that would be the best thing that you can do as a first aider towards any venomous poison, even the most venomous or most lethal, we would call it.
If you are asking about very specific in Malaysia, you can see most species in Malaysia, the worst is the neurotoxicity. The second part is hematotoxicity. But I think what kills a patient most is because of the neurotoxicity, in which there is a paralysis, respiratory paralysis, in which patient unable to breathe. That the most significant cause of death in snake species in Malaysia. And this is the fastest effect, and then the dangerous effect, because patient unable to breathe, and then patient become died because of the mass paralysis. If in Malaysia, for hematotoxicity, less likely to cause death, and then the bleeding disorders is not so very so far we don't see any cause of death because of that. But related to death in Malaysia, one is either is because of the paralysis, Number two, because of the subsequent sepsis, and number three is probably because of the complications of probably severe anaphylaxis towards the antivenom. So to say that, what is the fastest or the worst complications toward snake venom in Malaysia? I will say it is neurotoxicity, in which it is from elapids. Then that's why it is very important for you to recognize any airway and breathing disability. Then we have to assist, do resuscitation, probably give the respiratory assistant ventilation, and to get the antivenom as soon as possible. Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much, doctors. Maybe we can have another one last question. So a final question would be, as a public, how do we confirm that the snake is venomous or non-venomous? Because we as public don't know really how to identify the species. So that's the last question from one of our participants.
That's why they ask you to take selfie, right? That's why they ask you to take selfie with the snake, right? Okay, you need to take the picture and you need to show us. This is the only thing, you know. If you're able to describe, Rex give us a lot of good atlas actually. Help us a lot in Sarawak. So even if they couldn't take the picture, they just identify and give us description. And when we call for help for Rex, usually they will help us. What type of snake is there? Okay, this is my opinion. Okay.
What if they really didn't take picture or they don't know how to describe the snake?
As I said, we treat the patient symptomatically. We treat the patient, not the snake, right? So we'll see what's the sign and symptom, and we observe them, and the area, the time, all this will help us to identify type of the snake. Okay. Maybe because I know when you are scared, when they're scared, they don't see anything, even the rope. Oh yeah, they cannot explain how is it, what's the color, what's all this thing, they don't know. Okay. So we Maybe always also
yeah. add a bit. How Rex help to identify, or what is the diagnosis that we normally use? Maybe Dr. Zainal can help us explain a bit how Rex works in terms of helping to identify, and if there is no specimen, how we should diagnose.
Okay. So yes, some patient may come with the unidentified type of snake or even animals. So the first one is we look for the symptomatic approach, in which we look what are the symptoms and signs that correlate with the syndromic we call it syndromic approach, that related to any group or species of snakes, number one. Either it is for in Malaysia, I think it's a bit more simple compared to Indonesia, because in Malaysia, either you have neurotoxicity, hematotoxicity, or myotoxicity. We don't have much problem with the compare, if you compare with the in Indonesia or compare with the Australia. It's more complicated, number one. So we go to from syndromic approach. Number two, we go from the, we can probably geographical area where is the incident happens. Then probably we can guess what is the most likely species of that snakes that involved. So based on this two, then probably, from look at the next is we look at sign and symptoms. We look at the wound and the sign. What are the bite appearance on that? And then if there's any demonecrosis or blisters, then we look at the characteristic. And then based on these signs and symptoms plus the geographical area, then we can have a best guess of what are the species. So based on this, we can treat the patient. If we look whether there's the antivenom is indicated or not. If indicated, then we have an options. Either we use neuropolyvalent for neurotoxicity, or hematopolyvalent for hematotoxicity, or even if you look at the geographical area, even patient presented with neurotoxicity, if you're able to guess it is likely to be Naja species, then we just straight away use Naja cautia antivenom straight away rather than we use neuropolyvalent. And even if a patient has hematotoxicity, but if the geographic area is less likely due to Calasalasma rhodostoma, for example, the case is that incidence occurs in probably in Johor. In Johor. So we don't because we don't have Calasalasma rhodostoma in Johor. So we just give a green pit viper rather than we give hematopolyvalent. But if the incident occurs probably in northern part of peninsula, then probably you can give hematopolyvalent. Okay. So it depends on the syndromic approach plus the geographical area. Then we get the best guess of what the species involved, and we give the antivenom either monovalent or gives a polyvalent that appropriate.
Dr. Maha, what about Indonesia? Is there any difference over there?
Yeah, I think the venomous or not venomous is difficult identification, and identification species same also to difficult the medical doctor or the nursing. And a long time ago, I remember Prof. Kal asked me about the consultation. Yeah, Prof. Yeah, and the rec. Many helping to Indonesia because many doctor and many nursing don't know about this identification. Until now, I have many group of the REC and have many innovation. This innovation with the WhatsApp, with the Telegram, with the many, I think because the many system on the handphone, I think all people, all doctor, all nursing have the handphone. It's very easy to consultation and very easy to have this identification. But because the many species, you know, 77 species venomous snake in Indonesia. I think all doctor not know all. If you know the species from Australia, Dr. Zainal asked it also, yeah, it's very difficult to look same, brown and brown, black and black and the other. But the different with the neurotoxin and the Asia area, all the center Indonesia, Sulawesi is Nusa Tenggara and West Nusa Tenggara is the specific island, not Asia and not Australia. I think the innovation about identification is very important to Indonesia. Last month, Dr. Kal remember the ICT cobra with the Taiwan, yeah, Taipei, Dr. Hung make. I think it's the good innovation also, but I don't know because very expensive. And this money, I think not buy to ICT, but buy to antivenom. The system of the identification help many doctor and many patient have the specific antivenom. If Now I'm a goal to buy antiphenom to my government, a seven species antiphenom buy to Australia and buy to Bangkok also to helping many cases in Indonesia. The innovation from the identification is the key important to helping many data. I hope Dr. Karl and Malaysia Toxinology Society help me to innovation the system to identification because Indonesia very far and many cases.
Thank you, Dr. Mahal. That was a very, interesting and interactive Q&A session. So, for your information, we are from the organizing team. We has prepared a short kahoot game for our participants to join. So the winner of the quiz will get this book about the land snakes are of medical significance in Malaysia. Okay, congratulations to our winner, who is Toxino. You can identify yourself in the chat box, and our organizing committee will contact you to see how would you redeem the prize. Okay, Prof. Nariman, would you like to give a bit of do you have anything to add on to end our webinar?
Okay, just I would like to thank again all the organizing committee and Prof. Associate Prof. Dr. Khaldun for making this webinar for medical students. Very good idea. I think I'm going to do it in UNIMAS too, if possible, with conjoined with UKM.
Yes, let's do it together.
So one of my classes is just joined, or we join with Indonesia also.
We have always opened it.
And as I said, I think hopefully you learn from this webinar. And rule number one, if you don't know, call for help, and you got the help already here. Okay, that's all from me. Thanks, Dr. Khaldun. Thanks, Dr. Maha. It's first pleasure to meet you. Thank you, Dr. Nabil. This is my first time my own junior also from UKM. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Prof. Nariman. I'll look forward to the next webinar, and hopefully we can have UNIMAS with us together. Okay, so to all the participants, you may scan this QR code for attendance and to get your respective e-certificate. And also don't forget to fill in our feedback form so we can organize a better webinar next time, and probably with UNIMAS together, okay? And yes.
Okay, we would like to express our heartfelt gratitude to all of our panelists for having their precious time with us today and sharing their knowledge. It was very mind-opening for me and Tong actually to know about this clinical toxinology today. And thank you to all the participants for joining us today. We hope you gained something new. With this, we would like to end this webinar. Thank you from me.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
See you. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Bye.
Bye.
Thank you. Bye, everyone.